Today we start the week 5 lecture. The first one will be on linear time invariant systems, impulse and step responses. This is chapter 5 of the course notes. The objective is to determine the output of an LTI system given the input and to define impulse and step functions. Recall that this course will focus on LTI systems such that if the response of the system to a specific input is known, then it is possible to determine the response of the system to any linear and time-shifted combination of inputs. In other words, the sum of alpha I xi of t minus ti produces the sum of I alpha I y of t minus ti. The primary benefit for an LTI system is that if you know the output for a given input, then you can determine the output for any arbitrary input. Let's look at an example. If x of t is an LTI system where x of t equals u of t has the output y of t equals e to the minus t u of t, and if x of t the input is the cosine of 4t, then the output y of t is equal to the sine of 2t, this can be represented by the following block diagrams that show u of t going through the LTI and e to the minus t u of t coming out. And the second block diagram has an input of cosine 4t and an output of sine 2t. What is the output y of t due to the following inputs? So the first one is a scaling problem. X of t is equal to a plus b u of t. So since we know that the output due to purely u of t is e to the minus t u of t, then we know y of t should be equal to a plus b e to the minus t u of t. So if the input is x of t is equal to negative 5 cosine 4t, then the output would be y of t equals negative 5 sine of 2t. Okay, if the input was x of t equals cosine 4t minus 2, we can rewrite this as the cosine of 4 times the quantity t minus 1 half. So this represents a time shift of 1 half. So the output would be y of t equals the sine of 2 times the quantity t minus 1 half, or sine of 2t minus 1. What if the input was x of t equals u of t minus t naught? Well, this is also a time shift by t naught, so the output y of t would be equal to e to the minus quantity t minus t naught u of t minus t naught. If the input was x of t equals 3 u of t, then the output would be y of t equals 3 e to the minus t u of t. Now let's look at one that's a little bit more interesting. X of t equals negative sine 4t. This represents a cosine shifted by 90 degrees. So I can rewrite this as the cosine of 4t plus pi over 2. Another way to write the cosine of 4t plus pi over 2 is the cosine of 4 times the quantity t plus pi over 8. So this represents a time shift of pi over 8. So the output would be y of t is equal to the sine of 2 times the quantity t plus pi over 8. Or you can rewrite that as sine of 2t plus pi over 4. So now I have a linear combination input, x of t equals 3 u of t minus sine 4 of t. So this is an example of the scaling and the addition properties of an LTI system at the same time. So the output y of t would be equal to, well, the output due to 3 u of t, which is 3 e to the minus t u of t, minus sine 4 t, but I know the output due to minus sine 4 t is positive sine 2 t plus pi over 4. So this would be plus sine of 2 t plus pi over 4. So now let's discuss impulse functions. An impulse or delta function is defined as delta of t equal to 0 for t not equal to 0, 0 everywhere except at 0, and the integral from minus infinity to positive infinity, or a little bit right before time 0 to a little bit right after time 0, delta of lambda d lambda is equal to 1. So the area under the curve is 1. And delta of 0 is not defined. There are two properties we have for an impulse function or delta function. The first one is that if you have a function phi of t times delta of t minus t naught, that's equal to phi of t naught times delta of t minus t naught. And the reason this is true is if you think about an impulse function, at time t naught. And then here we have a curve phi of t. If you multiply those two together, well, since the impulse function is zero except everywhere except at t naught, then it's like you're picking off the point right there. So that's why the result is phi of t naught. The sifting property states that the integral from a to b, phi of lambda, delta of lambda minus t naught d lambda, is equal to the integral from a to b, phi of t naught, delta of lambda minus t naught d lambda. That's from property one. And that can be rewritten as phi of t naught times the integral from a to b, delta of lambda minus t naught d lambda. Now recall that a to b, if it includes the impulse function, the area under the curve is a 1. If it does not include the impulse function, it's a 0. So the result is that you have phi of t naught if t naught is between a and b, and you have 0 everywhere else. Here's an example of what that would look like. If here's a and b, and here's my impulse function, t naught, and there's phi of t, then for t naught between a and b, I get the value phi of t naught. However, if here's my impulse function t naught, and here's phi of t, and a and b are over here, then that would be 0 because the integral is 0 at that point. A unit step or Heaviside function u of tau is defined as u of t is equal to 0 for t less than 0, and 1 for t greater than or equal to 0. We've seen this earlier in the course, so this is more of a review. Here's a graph of the step function, but note also that u of t is equal to the integral from negative infinity to t, delta of lambda d lambda. And this is true because if t is less than 0, then the integral produces a 0. But if t is greater than 0, then the integral produces a 1. Create a sketch of the following function. So let's start with delta of t plus 2. This means that it's 0 when t plus 2 is not equal to 0, and it represents the impulse when t plus 2 is equal to 0. Another way to write this is that it's 0 when t is not equal to negative 2, and it's the impulse when t is equal to negative 2. So if I made a sketch of this, here's my time axis, and here's the impulse function at negative 2. What about delta of negative 2t plus 3? This means that this is 0 when negative 2t plus 3 is not equal to 0, and it's the impulse function when negative 2t plus 3 is equal to 0. It's 0 when t is not equal to 3 halves, and it's the impulse function when t is equal to 3 halves. So if I made a sketch of this, here's the time axis, here's the vertical axis, and here's the impulse function at 3 halves. What about u of t minus 3? U of t minus 3 is equal to 0 when t minus 3 is less than 0, and 1 when t minus 3 is greater than or equal to 0. Or another way to write that is that it's 0 when t is less than 3, and it's 1 when t is greater than or equal to 3. So if I made a sketch of that, it's a step function that starts at time 3. Let's look at the last example. What about u of negative t over 2 minus 2? This says that you have a 0 when negative t over 2 minus 2 is less than 0, and a 1 when negative t over 2 minus 2 is greater than or equal to 0. So another way to write this is that it's 0 when t is greater than negative 4, and it's 1 when t is less than or equal to negative 4. So if I made a sketch of this, it's a flip step function that turns on at negative 4, as shown here. Let's try another example. If x of t is a linear time-invariant system, and x of t equals u of t yields the output y of t equals e to the minus t u of t, what is the output due to the following input xa of t? The first thing to notice is that xa of t can be written as a combination of two step functions. So it would be the step function with amplitude 3 that turns on at time 0 minus a step function with amplitude 3 that turns on at time t equal 2. So another way to write this is that x a of t is equal to 3 u of t minus 3 u of t minus 2. And since we have a time-invariant system, the output y of t would be, if the input is u of t, it's e to the minus t u of t. So the output for 3 u of t is 3 e to the minus t u of t minus 3 times the time-shifted output. So that would be 3 e to the minus t minus 2 u of t minus 2. Now let's look at in-class activity 4. Solve the following integral. The integral from negative infinity to positive infinity, u of 5 minus lambda, u of lambda minus 3, d lambda. First, let's write the definition of u of 5 minus lambda. U of 5 minus lambda is defined to be 0 for 5 minus lambda less than 0, and 1 for 5 minus lambda greater than or equal to 0. Which can be written as 0 for lambda greater than 5 and 1 for lambda less than or equal to 5. U of lambda minus 3 is defined to be 0 for lambda minus 3 less than 0 and 1 for lambda minus 3 greater than or equal to 0, which simplifies to 0 for lambda less than 3 and 1 for lambda greater than or equal to 3. So this integral simplifies to the integral from 3 to 5, because that's where both of these functions are 1, d lambda. So that is 2. Now let's try in-class activity 5. Solve the following integral. Solve the integral from negative infinity to t, e to the negative lambda, u of lambda minus 2, d lambda. Recall that u of lambda minus 2 is equal to 0 for lambda less than 2 and 1 for lambda greater than or equal to 2. So our integral reduces to the integral from 2 to t, e to the minus lambda d lambda. So this can be written as negative e to the minus lambda evaluated from 2 to t, which equals e to the minus 2 minus e to the minus t. And recall, this answer is only valid for t greater than 2, so this is u of t minus 2. Another way of stating that is, this solution is only true if lambda is between 2 and t, or another way of stating that is, or if t is greater than 2. Now let's look at in-class activity 6. Solve the following integral from negative t plus 2 to infinity, e to the negative lambda, u of 2 minus lambda, d lambda. First, let's write the function u of 2 minus lambda. U of 2 minus lambda is equal to 0 when 2 minus lambda is less than 0, and 1 when 2 minus lambda is greater than or equal to 0. So it's 0 when lambda is greater than 2, and 1 when lambda is less than or equal to 2. So rewriting my integral, the integral becomes the integral from negative t plus 2 to 2, e to the minus lambda, d lambda. So when I evaluate that, I get negative e to the negative lambda from negative t plus 2 to 2, which equals e to the t minus 2 minus e to the negative 2, and this is only true for lambda between negative t plus 2 and 2. So if lambda is between negative t plus 2 and 2, then this would be negative t is less than 0, or for t greater than 0. So you multiply this by u of t. So let's do the final example on page 3. Solve the following integral from negative infinity to t, delta of lambda d lambda. So this is an impulse function. So if I draw a graph, and here at time 0, here's my impulse function. And remember, when you integrate over the impulse function, the area under the curve is 1. And if you don't integrate over the impulse function, it's 0. So let's say t was on this side of the impulse function. From negative infinity to t, that would yield 0. However, if t was on this side of the impulse function from negative infinity to t, that would yield 1. So this integral becomes 0 for t less than 0, or 1 for t greater than or equal to 0. So the integral of an impulse function yields the step function u of t. For in-class activity 8, solve the following integral from negative t plus 1 to 5, delta of lambda minus 1 d lambda. So let's make a sketch of delta of lambda minus 1. Delta of lambda minus 1 is an impulse function at time 1. If I integrate from negative t plus 1 to 5, I have two choices for negative t plus 1. Negative t plus 1 could be on the left side of the impulse, or negative t plus 1 could be on the right side of the impulse. If negative t plus 1 is on the left side of the impulse, then I'm going to have 1 for negative t plus 1 less than or equal to 1. If it's on the right side of the impulse, I'm going to have 0 for negative t plus 1 greater than 1. 0 for t less than 0, and 1 for t greater than or equal to 0, which is equal to u of t. Let's do in-class activity 9. Solve the following integral from negative 6 to t minus 3 for delta of lambda plus 2. First, we're going to make a sketch of delta of lambda plus 2. Delta of lambda minus 2 is an impulse function located at negative 2. So now let's draw negative 6 and t minus 3. So negative 6 is on the left side of the impulse function, and t minus 3 can either be on the left side or the right side of the impulse function. If it is on the left side, then you never integrate over the integral. So it is 0 if t minus 3 is less than negative 2, and it's 1 if t minus 3 is greater than or equal to negative 2. So if we simplify this, this gives us 0 for t less than 1, and 1 for t greater than or equal to 1. So another way to write this is u of t minus 1. Okay, let's look at in-class activity 10. Solve the following integral from negative infinity to t minus 3, e to the negative t minus lambda, delta of lambda minus 2 d lambda. So this is an example of our sifting property, which means I can rewrite this integral as the integral from negative infinity to t minus 3. And remember, it's going to pick off the point where it intersects with delta of lambda minus 2. So I can rewrite this as e to the minus t minus 2 delta of lambda minus 2 d lambda. So this means I can now factor out that function which does not depend on lambda. So this becomes e to the negative t minus 2 times the integral, where I have 0 for t, where I have t minus 3 less than 2, and 1 for t minus 3 greater than or equal to 2. So this equals e to the minus t minus 2 times 0 for t less than 5, and 1 for t greater than or equal to 5. So the final answer would be e to the minus t minus 2 u of t minus 5. Now let's try in-class activity 11. I have the integral from negative t minus 1 to infinity, e to the negative t plus lambda, delta of lambda plus 3 d lambda. So once again, I can use the sifting property and rewrite the integral as negative t minus 1 to infinity, e to the negative t minus 3, delta of lambda plus 3 d lambda. So I can factor out the exponential, which does not depend on lambda. So that's e to the negative t minus 3 times the integral 0 for negative t minus 1 greater than negative 3 and 1 for negative t minus 1 less than or equal to negative 3, which equals e to the negative t minus 3 times the quantity, which is 0 for t less than 2 and 1 for t greater than or equal to 2. So finally, the final answer is e to the negative t minus 3 u of t minus 2. So now let's look at the final example. Solve the following integral from negative infinity to positive infinity, u of t minus lambda, u of lambda minus 1 d lambda. U of t minus lambda is a step function that can be defined to be 0 for t minus lambda less than 0 and 1 for t minus lambda greater than or equal to 0. Or another way of writing that is 0 for lambda greater than t and 1 for lambda less than or equal to t. U of lambda minus 1 is a function that is 0 for lambda less than 1 and 1 for lambda greater than or equal to 1. So if I make a sketch here, if this is lambda, here is the function u of lambda minus 1, and here is the function u of t minus lambda. So when I find the integral will only be non-zero when the left graph intersects the right one. So this is going to be the integral from 1 to t d lambda or t minus 1. And this is only true for lambda between 1 and t or t greater than 1. So it's t minus 1 times u of t minus 1. And this concludes lecture 5-1 on linear time invariance.